everybody, and welcome to yet another episode of Who Knew, the weekly show where we discuss all things pop culture, comic books, movies, TV shows, games, etc., and tell you all the things you might not know about them, even though you definitely already do. It's another week, there's plenty to talk about, and we're here to bring comic book, movie, TV show news straight to your ear holes, as we do every single Monday. I'm Harry, and as ever, I'm joined by my co-host, Matthew.
Can you call me an esteemed co-host, because there's a match to talk about, and joke in there somewhere.
Of course, I'll bear that in mind for next week. And Annabelle.
Hello, I'm happy to be called co-host. I'm happy
I'm not. You're not esteemed.
I'm not esteemed. Okay. Right,
slightly broth. I'm the pre-packaged microwave host. I am brought to the world. Oh dear. Right, so with the intro done and some of the jokes have been shared, let's dive straight into the news. There's quite a lot of it this week, so what have we got to bring to our audience of 10? Let's...
There's quite a few people that go through that.
Cool. So,
because I've seen the queues at that time.
There's been some Batman vs. Superman news that's coming up thick and fast because it's released next month.
Yeah.
So we've got some more news. So what have we got?
There's a television that's going to be rated R.
Okay.
And then I think the runtime is 2 hours and a half or 2 hours 40.
Wow.
It's like a little bit too
much.
If they say that they've got more than they've shown, they've still got to cram in a lot of other
things. Yeah,
I'm pretty sure they sort of got Aquaman as well, isn't it?
I think Ken and Cyborg are just cameos.
Oh, so just cameos?
No, I think Flash is a cameo as well.
Cram everyone in. It's like the Avengers, except not, right?
I kind of want to see it now. It's been, like, since 2013, since we knew it was happening. The longer it's been on, I'd like to see it before anything changes my mind.
Yes.
I'd like to see it because it's just been bloody ages. I've just been seeing it because I've been on a Superman at this point. I'm like, just release it. Let me see it before my opinion is currently doubtful.
Yeah.
And DC, they release their films like once every 6 years, whereas Marvel are churning out like 2 a year at this point.
It's like it's going to nice to
get into it. You'll be seeing it,
that's for sure. The art, that's interesting. Yeah. But it's obviously not the one that's coming out in cinemas. It's making it insane to so limit their audience.
And yeah, that's going to want to push to like the biggest superhero
on this series. If Suicide Squad's going to be R as well, it's like, hey, something you that most people can't watch it.
Where it attacks all those SWAT
people. And then Bath theme wakes up.
Yeah. and he's like kicking around. Which film is it where he flies through the air and spears the two guys?
Fast special. I think that might be the Wolverine.
Yeah,
I think that had R-rated stuff in it on the DVDs and things, so I was thinking that's where
it goes. It has potential for it, and I think it could work, but there is a lot of talk of other films being R-rated as well, which I don't necessarily think
is a debate.
Yeah,
James Gunn said it best, and the people are going to learn the wrong lessons from that work, and I think everything needs to be R-rated rather than being like, oh, this movie can be R-rated.
Exactly. I remember you telling me before we started, Deadpool has overtaken Passion of the Christ as the highest R-rated film in history. So, of course, all producers of superhero movies go, the Passion of the Christ is the highest grossing R-rated film of all time, and now it's been overtaken by Deadpool really recently, so they're all going to be making R-rated films, which I think could be a problem. It works with some people, like Deadpool and Wolverine, they are R-rated characters. If you're going to start transforming every superhero movie into an R, I think of all the R-rated superhero movies in the past that have flopped. So that's a lot.
I did well, didn't it?
Kind of got.
I did well enough to get two sequels.
Yeah.
It's like one sort of critically
flopped. Yeah, flopped. Like, and then
when I financially done well.
Washington did okay.
Yeah, but it kind of passed under the carpet a bit, like just flew by. I mean, it's like 3D films. No one likes 3D films. You see it in 2D or you see it in IMAX. Wearing the dark, real 3D glasses just ruin the film. And that came off the back of Avatar, where Avatar made so much money. And for some reason, movie producers thought it was because it was in 3D. Whereas I think it was more the world building that bought it. But then...
But it's made for 3D.
Yeah, so like, but then they implemented 3D for every year.
Because like, you'll get bloody sad, tear-jerky drama film, and it's like, oh, my God, someone's going to really show and touch the tears.
I think they could take the wrong lesson from this again and start churning out R-rated superhero films, but it's not media.
You can't make Captain America R-rated, like,
yeah.
They can say them all.
And he's already said no to that
language.
It might keep it under control, it might go all off the rails, it works with some, or it doesn't work with others. I guess we can only see how that goes, because they're not going to listen to us really, are they? So,
yeah, it's like people comparing Batman with Superman and Watchmen saying he's just going to have a sex scene between Mats and Sue to set to hell in the year again.
Yes.
Like,
what all of the film?
The whole film. And that's like a memory channel.
It's a G-rated kind of just all the party scenes and everything looks, and then they come back in a little bit scrappy. And then it's like North by Northwest, one of them just makes like a slight social innuendo, and then it's like the train goes into the tunnel,
and then they're in the party after they've come out, and like, Luther comes over, it's like, ah, it's Bruce Wayne and Clark Kent, you guys should meet. And then they're kind of looking at each other like, if I leave you.
And then they turn on the camera and freeze frame, like, oh yeah,
that's the end of the movie.
And it does it. A little tune at the end of Seinfeld scene. It's like, oh, wow, I come out.
Can you imagine the kind of your enthusiasm?
Set you up! The sound ever played was so bright, so yeah.
Change the topic, please.
Okay, that's a good
one. Yeah, so the first point of the topic.
In other news, Pacific Rim 2 has finally been confirmed, and they put a director on it, the former dead. by Stephen S. DeKnight, so that is a piece of pedigree to go to this film. He's done some really, really good stuff, and I love Pacific Rim so much. As I've said, I think almost once an episode, kaiju films are my thing, and there's nothing I love more than massive robots being the out of massive monsters. It was such a good film. It was such a good film. I loved it. I watch it every time I do like a marathon of movies with my friends. Comes out, but it's every day or something. It's here on the screen.
As you feel that note,
I don't know, because this is the problem. He did a really good job at the first one, and it's kind of his thing, and it's got that signatures on it, like the bright, vibrant environment. I think once that's been established, someone can really riff off of it and continue it, but bring something fresh. Because whilst I enjoyed it so much, I'm by no means saying that Pacific Rim was a noteworthy film.
Oh, yeah, just that.
Is it going to go down in history as karma? What a story, what great characters. It was just a colourful, bombastic, slamming action. Yes, so I think
awesome.
That it looks good. It had a serviceable enough plot with characters. It's not sort of Steve Jobs, basically. So I do think bringing in
definitely some of our scene.
Steve Jobs and Steve Wolf, you know, slugging it out. One in a modified Apple II. One in the Macintosh, which wasn't started up 40 minutes before the presentation. Bringing a director like DeKnight to it, he's got such, he's really got a good catalogue of stuff behind him. I think bringing someone fresh to the franchise, it can only make it better. So I'm really excited for that.
I'll be seeing that in IMAX. It's an interesting thing that, like, the first call I'm projecting it off for a while, so he's not helping. what else hasn't happened? PT, the Silent Hills thing. He did meet up with, like, Kojima a couple of years ago or something. I don't think they can use it. I feel like it's probably somehow contracted away.
I saw a
horror game.
Morgan Reed of Sweden, like, one day, posted the other day, he posted a picture of it as the news broke that they had been in discussions again.
It might be something like, is the maker of Castlevania a similar thing where they went allowed the IP for a sequel, like, to Castlevania, so they just basically put out the exact game on a different day. Like, this isn't Castlevania, but it is.
Good stuff.
Seats that are which can grow organically.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, because Black Panther's relatively, like, he's more of a quieter character in terms of popularity than Iron Man and Captain America. So when they are bringing in, there's a lot of Marvel's main player properties up with other studios, so they're working with what they've still got on the table for them. So to bring in Black Panther is good, but if you just jumped into it, people might kind of lose interest in bringing him in. And introducing his universe steadily is a nice way of...
But they don't even know with the plot of it, you know.
Yes, yeah.
Because he's the one who kills T'Challa's father.
Yeah.
I feel like it's either already happened or they'll do something maybe a little bit different.
Yeah, maybe a bit different, or maybe I'm thinking his film might have a few kind of flashbacky origin type things.
Yeah, so I think it's a move in between, like after Infinity War Part 1, hasn't it? I think it was like a movie before, and now it's moved. In between. I'm guessing that, like, Infinity War Part 1 were not prepared to a degree. Otherwise, yeah, Part 1, I don't think they can announce something completely unrelated to what we were in.
So,
while we wait for Thanos to make his trek across the universe, finally. The Scarlet Witch one's Scarlet Witch, right? I'm waiting for Scarlet Witch to lose control completely.
Yeah, I would like to see that as well. You saw a small glimmer of it when Quicksilver died in Age of Ultron.
Yeah,
I saw that small bit and I was like,
it's that when she rips Ultron's heart out and when she bursts through the door after her Hawkeye's Avengers speech.
Yeah, so I'm hoping we'll see even more of that. That'd be really cool.
But there's other ones just like that, Tony and Steve kind of close to each other.
Stealing the Batman vs. Superman story.
It's going to be a glorious romance. That's what it is. Every character knows what this film is.
There's a photo of Chadwick Boseman with Falcon and Cap as well. You know, when you kind of see Iron Man in the trailer.
Yeah,
he's got that white shot. Seems like he's there as well. And then there's the kind of couple that were in the Super Bowl spot.
Okay, so.
Some of them you haven't already seen
to play us through until we get that.
So we'll get one soon. Right, he'll probably be attached to Batman Superman, probably. I don't think they really control what's being shown in front of
them. Yeah. I don't think they'd intentionally
It's around the right time.
Yeah.
It's going to be a big enough movie.
And they know that their audience will most likely be seeing a superhero film, so they will probably be released around that time. I think by mid-March, we might see a trailer.
That would only be up to half one.
Yeah,
that's the right time. I find it weird that there's that space between them, but like, they're working on the same day when they're out different clubs. Because I imagine we've got a top from here, we've got a top of the weekend, because then people are talking about it when they come back.
Like Civil War and Batman vs. Superman, but Civil War versus Batman vs. Superman.
Yes,
versus.
From the box office.
Sort of who makes the most money.
The shadows rise and the nerds pour in.
It's like fights to decide which screen they're going to go into. There can only be one.
They're the whole character posters, so I think they're calling them the 15-second teasers.
I've not seen these either. I've missed out a lot this week.
You're not missing much.
Like, it's not directly related to my interest.
You know how in the calendars they're all chained up?
Yes.
Yeah. There's one of them with him, and he screams, and then I think Foggy's in an alley when we're walking down the street, and he turns to his ear, and then the Punisher, I think, has an assault rifle, he's taking aim.
Punisher has a gun?
Yes.
Oh my god.
They really turned him down. Electro. Stabs two guys.
I've seen the Electro one.
And I think on Karen.
There is one character. I think she's has like a huge case in front of her or something.
Not like a huge case.
Yeah, but if they release the Karen bear, you just can't see her. And she's like, I flew out the day after I finished True Blood to film Daniel season one, and this is what they gave me.
As a gesture of
being every scene in the next season, she's just covered by a giant suit.
They go so far, really, like, that's what they do when people are broken, it's what they did with the house of having a family mother. It's just when they put on weight. The suitcase moves, it's on wheels, just to
keep her going or the talk scenes. In other Netflix, Marvel, TV news type thingies, I guess it's not strictly news as such because it's already happened, but I was watching an interview recently with Kristen Ritter, who played Jessica Jones in Jessica Jones, and she told a nice little story about about David Tennant, where apparently he was so excited about being in Jessica Jones that whenever his name was called to Mr. Tennant, you're on set, he would leg it to set, I guess, up and run. And apparently they all thought maybe it was to get some exercise or to get the blood flowing. You're kind of sat around all day in a studio sometimes. But no, apparently he was just super excited to get on the set and film his pieces. So it's like that gave me a little smile, not a bit of David Tennant used there.
I like David Tennant, I think, with everyone else.
We all love him, right?
Yeah.
That's great.
Well, he's the golden boy.
DC casting news. They went, I think the actress
of Christ, where is she from?
I can't make that joke. they're doing this show called Panels, which I think I think from some office on
Dialogues.
Yeah. It's on NBC comedy about insurance people, and like ordinary people in a world with superheroes. So Vanessa Hudgens was cast, but Vanessa Hudgens isn't a bad actress.
Vanessa Hudgens is fantastic. I mean, she was a person.
People like Grease Life. So,
oh, yeah, Grease Life as well. Grease Life.
Yeah. So this is kind of like Marvel's damage control.
Yeah.
The construction team have to rebuild after every superhero kind of battle destroys the city.
Yeah, and they're also doing a show on that, apparently. So,
okay. Yeah, these could be really interesting. I can imagine like a kind of office type.
Yeah. Or Alan Tudyk's and Danny Boone are in them. And Alan Tudyk is great at comedy. He's
great. Yeah, he's just great.
Yeah, he made a web series last year. Which is about him leaving to dimensions and things, and it surprised me how funny it was.
Mm-hmm.
But then Danny Boone was in Community. I hope that would mean he would jump. If he gets a pilot script, then he's not like, oh, this is fun. I can do this.
Danny Boone's already been in the Winter Ski, was already in. Oh.
Yeah, it's weird. Cross contamination.
Yeah,
cross contamination. Yeah. Something tells me he's not just going to take a pilot because he can. He's going to like it. He knows what comedy is, he knows what good comedy is.
I'll be interested to see that. That sounds quite a lot more streams.
At first, it was a little bit midlife when they just announced they were doing it because it's hard to get invested in that.
Yeah.
And like the same way it's hard to get invested in the office and parts of Rec, like small government
in America.
Parks and Rec was an office spin-off anyway.
Yeah, I enjoy Parks and Rec, but I guess because the US office is spin off of such a good British series, it just didn't manage. For me, so yeah, everyone always talk about the office.
CSRfm is the podcast.
Yeah. The whole thing is just us about the office. But I didn't like the British show.
What is that noise? Oh my god, what
the office is haunted!
Okay, I'm gonna
tell you what I
know.
I don't know. Because I'm gonna plump with a
meal. Yeah, because I like to use it.
I think someone might have been dragging something across the floor in
the main room. That hatch slinging.
I'm going to start that section again. It was really amazing.
Yeah.
Okay. So we now move on to our world famous segment, but it's not quite daily. The Daily Ridley, where we talk anything and everything to do with Star Wars. There's not that much news this week, or rather not that much exciting news this week, but there's a few little bits. We've been notified that there's going to be deleted scenes included on the DVD and Blu-ray release of Episode 7. There's not been too many details of what they're going to be or how many, but the person who gave the information said there was going to be a maybe 7. One of them involving Han, one of them involving Rey, and one with Maz Kanata in her, and that one is rumoured to be her showing that she can use the Force.
Okay,
and her escape, so I'm quite interested.
Is it during the castle sequences?
Yeah,
so are the Rey's running?
Yeah, when Rey goes running and they have to take on the attacking First Order, so yeah, I'll be interested to see that. Also news that they have turned a street in Dubrovnik, Croatia, into what looks like what we've seen on desert planets such as Tatooine before, so they kind of coated the buildings in a exterior design.
It does its job great,
because that's what we need. They've decorated these buildings in ways that are reminiscent of the designs we've seen in Tatooine. And also, my favourite Star Wars news of the week.
Yes. This is how we get everything.
This is just how we get kicked up the radio.
I found this picture. It came up on Facebook.
One of the
Star Wars groups. I found it incredibly amusing.
exists.
There's this picture, it made me chuckle. I'm probably going to cut this bit out from the live broadcast, but I just wanted to say it. It's the bit where she's restrained in the Starkiller base, and someone has taken the picture of her in the chair, and she's looking at the stormtrooper, and they put the caption underneath, lock the door and tighten my restraints. And she's got this, like, look in her eyes, and it's really amazing. It made me laugh. It doesn't work so well on radio when I'm describing the picture. Yes. I'm going to post it on our official Twitter. It's going in the way down. So that's the thing that happened that I found it amusing. There's nine gag lols.
Main topic here.
Yeah, so that brings the Daily Ridley to a close for this day slash week. Moves us nicely onto our main topic, which we are going to be discussing this week. It is The Walking Dead, because that has come back recently. We'll be three episodes in by the time this is broadcast. Let's discuss it. Season 6, mid-season, second half. The opening episode of the second half of the season, in my opinion, was fantastic. I'll give you that. It was action-packed. It's just everything you want to see in a zombie film, just whacking skulls, defending their home, and some things going wrong here and there. So there was a big comic book moment. Carl got his eyes shot out, and they killed off Jesse and her family, and Rick had fallen in love with her in the first half of the season, and then had to hack her arm off to get Carl to safety.
It's happening.
Yeah.
Rick has to kill.
Yeah.
As Rick doesn't die. As the dino. Rick doesn't die, because Rick's the main character.
Yeah.
The main character has been all like,
this week, that's weird. This happens for a while. It's like, Carl will eventually be the main character, or something. Or Carl is meant to be the main character.
Carl's meant to be the main character, but I don't think it's the age where we can have sexual tension with him and someone
else. No, it's not. Yeah, they got weird in the comics.
I don't think it's weird in the comics.
There's like a 2-year age gap, and then at some point someone licks his eye socket. Different strokes.
Some of those strokes are licking people's eye sockets.
Yeah, the opening episode of the second half of the season was really good. They were just surrounded by zombies, backed up, just beating them to death.
It's the one people have been waiting for since they got to Alexandria.
Yeah, exactly. It's that big moment. I enjoyed it. I said this, and my friend Tom said this as well, and we were discussing it afterwards. If that had been a standalone 45-minute short film, just in a generic zombie apocalypse, that would have been, I would have really enjoyed that. It would have been a stellar thing to see. So, yeah, I really enjoyed it.
Am I right in saying, like, at the end of mid-season, Abraham and others would, like, kind of help us, or help us get the hell out? And then, like, they do something about it pretty quickly.
Yes, yeah. Daryl blows these guys that are holding him, Abraham and Sasha, at gunpoint, just blows them to smithereens with a rocket launcher. So
it's getting stuff done quickly, which
they
haven't done for a while.
Powering through those building the tension. So I really enjoyed that. Because I thought that was going to be a bit of background arc of the whole episode. Then ringing up, it was just I really enjoyed that.
How did you feel about the second episode?
Second episode, I think it was a good episode, but after the strength and the action of the first episode, it was a kickback into first year after being in 5.
And I think that's maybe the main problem with Walking Dead. I'm kind of watching it, but not day after it comes out. I'm kind of like giving it some time and when I feel like it.
Okay, I'm watching it like day after because I've always enjoyed it. They introduced Jesus, who's a big character in the comic book, so it was cool to see him.
Not Jesus.
Just a guy called Jesus.
Does he have a beard?
Yeah, he's basically looks like Jesus, and he doesn't use weapons and that kind of thing, so it's
he's on the water.
Yeah.
He's got water and wine.
Oh, no.
It's not to me, because
he's concerned with that.
Right now, I think he can do with water, because he pushed all of their gear to the bottom of the lake by accident, so
that's a fair thing.
Yeah, and then they...
I sent all of your stuff to the bottom of the ocean. Oh, well.
Guess we're stuck for these 3 months until they drop dead.
It was a quiet episode. The big bit that's got everybody talking is they finally got Rick and Michonne together after kind of hinting at it throughout.
Yeah.
Yes. I personally was thinking it wouldn't happen and almost hoping it wouldn't happen. It didn't happen in the comic book. She's with Tyrese Morgan and Ezekiel.
Yeah.
So Ezekiel's on the time.
Yeah.
So she's a real, she goes off to the bad boys. I thought it wouldn't happen. They kind of alluded to it in the fact that she's become a surrogate mother.
Yeah,
Harlan Judith. They've kind of developed it. Her and Ridley have kind of developed this mother-father relationship without the sexual tension. And I thought that was where they were going to go with it. They were going to be a happy family, but there was going to be no...
Hanky-panky.
But, you know, everyone went out for it, so I guess, you know, do what they want with it. It'll be interesting to see where it goes. It's not like dislike it, I just wasn't bothered.
You weren't invested in the relationship.
Yeah, exactly. I was invested in the relationship, how it was, and just this, they are a team, and that is it.
Yeah,
but it doesn't bother me either way, so that was a thing that happened that I don't care about. So, I might grow into it.
Like, if it's already shit.
Yeah, exactly.
Like,
the way I think it's, the guy is a fantastic actress who plays Michelle, and so is Andrew Lincoln. You know, they're both stellar. So
he is a lot, actually.
It's
This is not only Empire. Don't watch The Walking Dead anymore.
Well, when did you drop off?
When did I drop off? Season 3. End of season 3 now.
Well, like, reel it back. So, like, yeah, what are you guys think of Walking Dead in general?
I like it to a degree.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like I'm not expecting to sustain 3 episodes of high caliber.
Okay.
The first 2 episodes of season 5 were incredibly good.
Yeah.
When they're dealing with the remainder of the seniors and they're in the camp. Like, that first scene in season 5 was really intense when they went to slaughter.
Yes, yeah.
That was the way it kind of built and brings Carol closer, and then it kind of descends into the camp, is the right way to do it.
Yeah.
And then he has the stuff in the church, and then the stuff with Bob, and with him explaining everything.
Yeah.
And then the prisoner slows down for me. Oh, that's not, I mean, hospital.
Oh, okay. So,
with Beth.
Yeah,
that's right.
Seems good.
Like, and that one's a weird, because it's in season 4 when she gets abducted, and they're like, at all in their different locations, and it's doing other things, that's right.
Mm-hmm.
And then it doesn't pick up on it, so it's been 6 or 7 months, without you mentioning, really, like, which, in actuality, it's only about a week, I think.
In story time, yeah.
It's kind of one of those weird things where it then slows all the way down.
Yeah.
It struggles to transition between the big arcs.
I can see where you're coming from. This. Wonder what about you?
Yes.
Mumble it away over there.
I'm a good mumble. My opinion towards the one is, having watched up season 3, I can't say anything else then. But season 1 was fantastic. Season 1, like, I marathoned through. Like, it was incredible to me. I was like, oh, yes, this is fast paced. But, like, it builds up to fast paced excitement. And then season 2 is obviously the big dropping point.
Yeah, that's kind of renowned, is it?
The renowned is terrible.
So, yeah.
You can stroll apart season 2 and then you can be out. Yeah. Yeah, I couldn't get through, like, it's not like I couldn't get through it, I obviously did, I watched through season 3, but season 2 was, like, disappointing,
yeah.
And it just, like, my hopes for the show, obviously after loving season 1, descended massively, and I was like, oh, okay, well, my hopes are, like, low for season 3, going to season 3, and to me it felt like more of the same.
Yeah.
I know it wasn't really, like, I had bits of dead government and stuff, which was interesting, but it wasn't enough to keep me really interested and invested in it.
Once Scott didn't want to go, but he did kind of the best episodes of the seasons 2 and 3, he did catch up on the guy to Morgan, and he's kind of saying,
yeah.
It picked up in quality, and it kind of got to the point where it's a good show, at least.
Yeah, I mean,
I don't think there are points that it's bad. I think there's kind of points where I don't like it as much.
Okay. I mean, to me personally, I love The Walking Dead. I love the comics. I got really into the comics. Then I dropped off the comics for a while, so I started reading other stuff. Then the TV show came out, and I got into that. And then I got back into the comics. So I've always liked it. Season 1, really good, solid 6 episodes. It was a pilot season. Really worked well. Season 2, like, and as I said, it went downhill, but, like, obviously it wasn't that bad because it kept going afterwards. And I watched all of it all the way through. There's some good episodes in there, like the Armageddon bit at the end where the bomb goes down and down to the table.
Obviously, really also fear it picks up.
Yeah. especially when he's the only one hunting for Sophia, and you start to warm up to this character who was previously really cold and cut off. I enjoyed it for that, even in the quieter episodes where there was some character building. But I appreciate, you know, that's not The Walking Dead is about, it's about character building. So when I recommend it to friends who haven't watched it, and I did this when my friends were asking about getting into it, I kind of gave them a list of cherry-picked episodes from Series 2. I said, if you watch them, you will hit Series 2, and you will just drop out as you, like, what you want from this show. You will end up being like, well, this is terrible. So I cherry-picked the best action, a few, so that I kind of narrowed it down, and then they powered through it and loved The Walking Dead as much as I do. So I think you do have to cherry-pick what you watch in Season 2. Season 3, really like that. They saw the prison, they introduced the governor, and there was that kind of, eventually, right at the end of it, we saw kind of this glimmer of hope that they were going to have this society. And then Season 4 opens up into that society is now fully fledged out. It functions, it's a new world, but it's reminiscent of the world that they left behind them.
The story I heard was that Robert Kirkman, like, the issue after he cut the hand off, like, and then
so many differences, like in the prison, it's Tyrese who gets killed by the governor. Herschel has more children than he does in the show, but Beth isn't one of them. She is purely for the show. Carol is this really bizarre. At one point, she asks for a threesome and to be married to Rick and Laurie to become like a three-way family. The comic book is so don't let kids read the comic. Herschel's kids get his 9-year-old daughters are playing in the barber shop in the prison, and they are decapitated by one of the prisoners. He kills them.
And that's like a killing them.
Yeah.
One of them's kind of curious about the dead, but he knows the other.
Yeah, but they kind of do that with,
Lizzie
and Lizzie and Mika.
Yeah,
and then,
it sounds like, I haven't read the comics, but to me it's sounding considerably more interesting than the show.
I think it's the comic book. Yeah. It's really good because there's certain things they can't do on network telly, like heading to 9-year-olds. In the comic books, Laurie's death is far more brutal at that point as well. Baby Judith is killed, whereas she's still alive in the TV show because she is down by the fence at the prison when the governor attacks.
Yeah.
She runs back to the prison to get Rick, but the governor shotguns her in the back. She falls and her weight crushes Baby Judith. If you liked elements of The Walking Dead but fell out of favour with it, I highly suggest picking up the comic books because the comic books are amazing. I say pick it up. They're always find it free online. I'm not going to tell you what, but there are ways. Why I love The Walking Dead in all of its forms, TV show, comic book, and from what I've seen of the games, it takes a generic genre that's so popular, i.e. zombie apocalypse, but it has distinguished itself from the pack and made it its own thing. The way it exists in a world where zombies were never part of popular culture, so they don't know what they are, which is why they're called walkers, biters, etc., etc., but always referred to by a different name. It's never been said in the writer of the comic says it never will be said how the zombie apocalypse started. You are introduced with Rick months into it. You never know. And he says he will, as far as the foreseeable future for him is, he will never conclude it. It will just continue. So that is kind of built its own way in the world, and it is such a popular TV show.
Yeah, well, like, maybe it's after having watched it and it being kind of popular, but I don't know if it's how much it's doing differently.
Well, I think just like the idea of
the zombies on this TV show, other than the idea of them not particularly existing, so they use other words for it.
Yeah, that's kind of like stuff that I can't remember the series of books, but it's kind of like Miles missing, and they have different names for them, aside from zombies, even though they are essentially.
So I feel like Charlie Gibson series.
Yes, yeah. So I feel like it kind of became ingrained in like, the zombie related culture.
Yeah, and it just cut off its own space that other people have had some of that.
And so by now, it's one of those things that we don't believe and realize that we need to hear, I guess.
Like, maybe it's just me looking back on it with the knowledge of how popular the Walking Dead is now.
Yeah. It's a Marmite show, like people either love it or hate it. It really does separate people.
I think people reach the point where they hang like, oh, no, something, and then it'll become amplified.
There's this brown nature about, one of the things I look at in shows and TV shows, I look at colours, because it really bores me when a show like The Walking Dead is essentially all brown.
That's true of the first few series, but especially now, more so where they're moving into more suburban and urban areas. It's a different thing, it's in a different setting, because the first half of the series was set in Georgia, which is a forested, mostly natural area in the south, and they've now moved north.
Sure, the dead's a little bit.
You'll never have to discussion there. I guess those were some thoughts on the whole thing. I think it was kind of a brash kind of mismatch. There was no structure to it, to be honest, but it was just, hey, these are our thoughts on this incredibly popular show. If you would like to see a more structured, you know, going through season by season, looking at more in-depth for certain characters, then we'll be more than happy to do that. That brings the main topic of the discussion about The Walking Dead to a close. Now, we would usually dedicate this time to our letters section, but we still haven't got any letters.
We can write letters.
Please write us. Please send us stuff.
I'll write an impassioned letter to be honest with you. Also,
write yourself letters and we can read them out. Yeah. That would be rambles.
So,
be subjected to an hour of Annabelle's rambles.
I think we're going to use this time to just have a kind of little look at the Oscars.
Last night,
the Oscars happened. So,
it's too bad.
Like, what were you hoping would win the best picture?
I think it'll probably be Spotlight, like my kind of pop culture hearts would like your hero to win.
Yes.
I don't think anything that deserves best director. I'm just going to look at each other best in it. If it's going to win one, then it should win that.
Yeah, I think it should win that. I would like it to win best picture, but I don't think it should.
What do you think it'll win?
Revenant, I think that one BAFTA. So, it's a good indication of the.
I saw that the Big Short was apparently a front runner as well. I think like people really like the Big Short, but I kind of feel like no offense to that and the Marsh, they were the lower ones on the spectrum.
Yeah. No, I love the Marsh.
Oh, I find it weird that it showed up. Like, it surprised me when I saw it in the nominations.
It's like a nice surprise.
I like the Marsh. I would again. Sure, but I think the Revenant will, looking at what it has won in previous award ceremonies, which are always an indication.
Yeah.
And equally, I think this year's Leo's.
Yeah. I don't want it to be it.
Really?
Yeah. Seriously. I feel like this year it'd be like, oh, we'll get it again because he hasn't had it.
I feel like it would feel like that, but I think he does that. Like, I honestly thought he was going to win Wolf of Wall Street.
Yeah.
I so thought that I wanted him to win that because that was a amazing film.
I feel like the Oscars kind of go, if someone has to suffer for their performance, then they're going to win.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's the right way to do it.
Yeah.
The one thing was I saw Steve Jobs a couple of weeks ago, and I was really impressed by it, and then when I started looking into what other people thought, I found a tweet from Steve Jobs and saying he forgot it was Fast Bender.
Right.
And so, like, kind of that's the one. I feel like I wasn't always aware I was watching Leo. I probably, like, got a best star.
It's like when you it's kind of like this is going to, you kind of think like this is going to be
this is
his performance. This is his
I think that's like Fassbender's obviously a front runner for it, and I think he blends the roles well. And I think Leo blends the roles well, but because he is so like everyone is so got their eye on Leo, it brings them out by their own looking at him like, is this Oscar bait? Is this
not Oscar? I was thinking that Eddie Redmayne would be one of the front runner.
I think he won last year, but he did one slightly
because
of that.
It's just a Slovenian drama.
Yeah.
That inspires tears.
I feel like as much as the Academy goes with what they think will be popular, I don't think they go for the danger. I feel like they would go for the
danger. Yeah, also, I know they're going to be like done pretty
much. I'm happy about it.
It's going to be Leo or Fassbender.
Yeah, if Brie Larson wins Best Actress, then I think
she'll win.
Yeah, she's kind of like waiting for guest spots on Community.
Yeah,
she's right in short term 12.
Thanks for the program. Cool.
So, she's come a long way from plays in those kind of films. So,
Install was a winning.
Technical stuff. I reckon it will win Best Music. Is it amazing?
I think it's Best Series, isn't it?
I'm sure it is.
Yeah.
Best Original Song.
No, it wasn't. Best Song is.
Yeah, they go from Frozen.
It's something to do with Paul Walker as well.
That's not the thing. David called the Star Wars Force Awakens.
I feel like you'll get those ones. I don't really think you. But people didn't really like the soundtrack as much.
I love it.
Yeah, no, it's I like it a lot.
I don't know if it's going to be Star Wars Force Awakens or Mad Max.
It's a sad thing because they are both such feats of technical brilliance. Yeah. They are going to be real competitors for it. I do think they will both win some. They're going to kind of share a myriad of awards in the more technical department.
I think that makes a bit of the prostrating range over the other.
Because
if he's Muslim, but I'm glad he's lost. Nice to meet you.
Yeah. He will win, I reckon. So we'll see this goes out after.
So I'd love him to find out tomorrow.
Well, yeah, I think that will win best nomination. I do think that's a, like, what else has there been that's been that good this year? Nothing. We can't cut this character. So I think Inside Out will win best animation. That's as many awards as I can kind of remember.
Yeah, the other ones are kind of getting the best one, right?
Yeah,
I know it's a best animated short, and there's like dark categories, which I'm not
going to allow.
Yeah,
I'm not on the pulse with them. Exactly. That brings our letters or Oscar section for this week. I need to
read us. Just in hindsight.
Now we go into our weekly recommendation section. This is where we kind of just bring you what we've been reading, doing, watching, etc. at the moment, so you can have some stuff you might want to get into, and it's just kind of to keep you up to speed with what's going on with us. So I will open, as I usually do. I have been watching Gravity Falls.
Yay!
I'm on the season, not season 6, episode 6.
Was it the Bill statue?
So I'm on episode 6, I think. I've just finished the one where Grunkle's fan has the wax work.
Oh, yes.
It's a really well voiced, really, like, the characters are so endearing, and it's just a really enjoyable, really kind of just takes you back to a carefree Saturday morning cartoons. I used to love the kids, so.
It gets less carefree.
Yeah,
it gets pretty hectic.
Yeah, I've been enjoying watching that. I've been reading, believe it or not, The Walking Dead, where I last left off, so I've been reading some more of that, and also I've been listening to another podcast.
For shame!
We were contacted by Twitter by another podcast who happens to share the same name as us. They are Who Knew Podcast, and we are Who Knew. So they cropped up on iTunes from going back and having a look in the time that we were planning our show. So it's not like we didn't steal the name or anything, and we're very amicable. We get on well on Twitter. So they gave us a listen. I've been giving them a listen. And it's two Americans. It's really quite fascinating because it's about stuff that I don't normally listen to. So they talk about healthy lifestyles, exercising, body cleansing. They talk about addiction and overcoming the recovery period. Like, they cover just a myriad of subjects. And I thought at first, like, this isn't really me. I think that's the point of their podcast, is they talk about stuff so you can get this insight into other people's worlds. So from a British guy who sits around in his room, doesn't eat vegetables, reads comic books, it's really quite nice to get an insight into the lives of these two Americans who have overcome struggles in their lives. They're now on health kits and stuff. The first episode, a quite big chunk of it is dedicated to talking about one of the hosts, Carmen, talking about her life. She's had one of these really Forrest Gump lives where she's done a little bit of everything. Like, she was in the TV and film industry. She worked in a leisure holiday centre in an island in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. And she's just led this life where she's done a little bit of everything. She's, like, literally packed up everything into a car, driven to Los Angeles, and just moved into a flat. She seems to have had this amazing life. Yeah, as I said, it's not the sort of thing that I would have normally sat down and listened to, but I did. And I just found myself really enjoying this insight into something I'd never previously considered looking into. So they share the same name as us. Go and give them a listen. Tell them we sent you. I recommend it. But it's just a really nice, intriguing, interesting thing that I never would have seen myself in before. So yeah, I really enjoyed it. It's fun. That's my weekly recommendations.
I finished reading Star Wars Dark Disciple, which is a book taken from Adrian Wallstreet, which Rome produced. Harry, you need to read it.
Yes, I want to read this. I saw a post on Facebook. I was like, yes, I want that.
It's really kind of intriguing. It takes more time than the show would have said for, but I think you can in a novel.
Yeah.
Have the time to describe things already, even on the page. X-Files finished this week. Don't watch any episode besides episode 3 of the reboot. If you know what's going to be like, I'll tell you afterwards. Flash revealed who Zoom was this week. It was met with a resounding shrug from me. It shouldn't be doing that when it announces its big bad. That's gone on a break for a month. Arrow will as well. I'm giving Arrow the rest of the season to see whether I drop that. Giving Legends 4 episodes. Agent Carter's going to finish that and add a musical number this week. is some of the most fun I've seen in the world.
That's amazing.
Also, I went to London Super Comic Con. I've been doing quite a few things.
And moving on from Matt's incredibly rich portfolio of what he's been doing.
Yeah.
Annabelle's been spending too much money on magic cards whilst watching and tracking almost everything that she can find on RuPaul's Drag Race UK.
You've been tracking stuff for this for a while.
CSRfm on a Monday, 6 to 7 p.m. GMT, and then we upload the full episode online afterwards. You can listen to us on iTunes, find us by searching Who Knew, and don't forget to leave us a review because we kind of need some of those to get us showing up more. We're also on YouTube. You can find us on there by searching Who Knew Podcast. You can find our official Twitter and Facebook page by searching Who Knew Pod on those respective sites. And the three of us are also on Twitter. You can find me at BTDubes, that's BTDOOBZ. You can find Matthew at
that underscore simply.
And Annabelle at.
Just don't follow me on Twitter. Unsatisfied. Don't do it.
Okay, there we go. And of course, don't forget you can contact us here in the studio at whonewpod@gmail.com. Please write us some letters. We need to fill the letters section with something. And if you forget any of that ridiculously long list of links, just remember you can find all of this information on our official website, www.whonew.podbean.com. Thanks for listening, guys. We'll see you next time.
Bye-bye.